Next up, we have Dennis Delacorte from BYU, who's going to tell us more about increasing our scientific visibility. All yours, Dennis.
Let's try again, unmute. Thank you, guys. I'm excited to be with you again, and thanks also to my former colleagues at Bayer. That was a great presentation. I'm really glad that you guys can leverage the allotrope data format now for really cool data science. So my goal today is to tell you a bit about what I have done in my dual role within Zontel and Brigham Young University to support the Allotrope Foundation with scientific publications, which is something that I pitched to you 6 months ago, and we have made some progress on it since then. And I hope that there will be some insights in this presentation that help you to understand and appreciate what these efforts might mean and how they can help you with your internal communications, and also might spark some ideas and potential topics that we can discuss afterwards to see if there are some other publications that could originate from the work that you have currently that you have done or you're currently doing. And so if you're interested in trying to push something forward so that other scientists can review it and becomes a bit more citable and broadly seen, we're definitely a team in the partner network, so the Brigham Young team, that wants to support that and help you guys all to get the good word out of the work that you're doing. So let me see if I can click this forward. Does this work? Is there supposed to be a button? I guess it did work. Okay, cool. So, just a couple of words about my lab at Brigham Young University. So, I joined the university 2 years ago in the role of assistant professor in the physics department. But over the last 2 years, we were a bit more successful with regard to getting external funding and so on. So, we have grown our team now to 16 people. Here's a snapshot, the one that was done right before COVID hit. And since we had everything virtually only, so I wasn't able to take another group picture, but we have doubled since. And the nice thing is that working with so many young people, they're really great talents at the very early stages of their careers, and to work with them and help them to develop further and get meaningful experiences and interactions also with industry members, like some of you that have been working with some of my students for out the last 6 months. It's really valuable. It's really valuable for the students, and I think also the results can be very valuable for everyone. So let me just tell you a couple of minutes what we are up to at Brigham Young University and why that connects with the goals of the Allotrope Foundation. So we have a vision and a goal. We really believe that in silico, drug discovery and protein engineering are going to be the main drivers of pharma R&D for the next 20 years. And this digital transformation is just the beginning of what's going to happen with the really rapid rise of high powerful machine learning and deep learning techniques. And so we are trying to build a leading center for molecular design that will be mainly staffed with full-time postdoctoral workers and then with a majority of undergraduates that run the experiments. And in that context, we are trying to find collaborations with biotech companies, with software companies, with pharma companies, in order to understand really what the current data is that's available, and then to build on that data the machine learning models that can turn data into drugs in the future. And so here's a recent research highlight that was published last week in Nature Scientific Reports from our group, where we have shown that our deep learning network, which we call PROSPER, is able to differentiate for two amino acid sequences that are very similar. I don't know if you can read it on the screen, it's kind of small on my end. But here is the two amino acid sequences, and they are 95% identical. There are only 3-point mutations on it. However, when you look in the NMR structures that are solved for them, they are very different folds. And it's very uncommon that very similar sequences have different folds. And so the question was, these alpha fold-like deep learning models, are they able to predict when you have very similar sequences, different folds or not? And what this shows you here, here are predictions from our lab and then from the Baker group that some of you might be aware of. It shows that we can pick up the difference in between the amino acid distances very, very accurately, and we can distinguish between these two folds. And that's really cool because it shows us that we are able to just look at the sequence of a protein. And if you, for example, have a cancer target and it goes through mutations and then changes its conformation slightly, we can run within like 30 seconds for our model and get the changes in the structure from that. And that can help us then with selection of, for example, secondary cancer treatments and things like that. So this technology is pretty cool, and we're pretty excited to apply it in a variety of settings. However, whenever you make things like this, there are two bottlenecks. Bottleneck A, what data do you have and what can you train your networks on? And B, how do you disseminate this data so that other people can reuse it properly? I've been working through this wonderful tool of GitHub for the last 2 years, trying to make our tools as broadly accessible as possible, but it's very, very difficult. And very often people run into problems that just cannot reuse your data, and you have to go through lots of iterations of communications. And I really think that what the Allotrope Foundation is trying to do and how we can benefit from it downstream is by putting something out there that will sort of standardize our data sets so we can train networks like this more effectively. And it will also give us a framework according to which we can disseminate our data so others will be able to leverage this more seamlessly. So that's a little bit of the motivation here. Those are, by the way, the two students that contributed to this paper. Anyway, let's keep going. So why do we care about Allotrope? Maybe just about my background. Before I joined BYU in Zontel, I was an employee at Bayer and have been sort of with Allotrope from its early days in 2015. Then when I left, I joined Zontel in 2019 as a chief science officer and Brigham Young University in 2018. In 2019, however, BYU also joined the Allotrope Partner Network. And then ever since, we are trying to grow our footprint. And one thing that we are frequently doing is writing these grant proposals. And you might be aware of it, but FAIR is an academic principle, and academics demand it without quite telling you what it is that they want. And so, for example, in these grant proposals, I have to write data management plans where I have to tell them how exactly my data will be reusable in the future. And I always have to make up a new argument for it effectively. And it's kind of weird, because when you want to have something really reusable, it should be according to a standard that doesn't change every 6 months, depending on who I write my grant proposal to. But right now I have to really trim it to the audience that's going to review it. And so I believe that if we continue to push Allotrope forward, eventually we'll end up with a world where scientific data exchange is more structured, and then it will not be so hard for people like me to write these grant proposals, because we're just going to say, hey, we're going to adhere to these data models within this Allotrope Foundation, and then our data will be easily interoperable and reusable. But we're not quite there yet. So let's talk shortly about what we have done so far in order to support the Allotrope Foundation. The first work that we did was published last year. That was a collaboration with the library at Brigham Young University and the Zontel company, where we tried to put library records that have 150 odd pictures in it or so into the Allotrope data format and disseminate those then to a broad historical community that uses the Brigham Young Library. It's one of the largest libraries in the US for ancestry reports, to build like family trees and gain like insights on where they come from and where the ancestors came from before they migrated to the US. And so one thing that you can show here is that the journal in which we published it is a very good journal. Digital Library Perspectives is the leading journal with regard to this type of domain. However, the Altmetrics score is pretty low. So this paper was published, was peer reviewed, but it didn't get a lot of traction yet. So that's something that's it's a bit sad, and that can always happen, right? When you put out something that goes through the peer review, it might get a few reads in the first couple of months, but then interest dies off or no one picks it up. And so in order to have a real footprint, it's not enough to just put one paper out and say, okay, I'm done, my work is published, but to rather have a consistent stream of papers that reference back to themselves and kind of build sort of like a scientific context. And I think that within the Allotrope Foundation, we really have a playing field, and not only for Brigham Young University, but for other academic partners as well, to start establishing kind of like this field of what it really means to bring FAIR data to the pharmaceutical industry. Pistoia has some of related papers, but I think the Allotrope Foundation has a sufficiently large footprint that it should be one of the key drivers of putting up this new domain within the scientific literature that can have more impact than individual standalone papers. And so we built on top of this, of course, another publication of ours called the Data Centric Lab will be presented end of this month at the Future of Information Content Conference. That one has been already through the peer review process and so on. It's in a publishing state right now with Nature, with a Nature book. So that will come out soon. And that will really talk about how we can break out of the application centric past into the digital data-centric future. And it outlines strategies for doing that, and including, of course, also the allotrope data format and the idea of going beyond what we have done in the past with proprietary data formats and trying to think we are safer in our silo and entering more into an interconnected lab world. Then a really recent one that I'm going to spend more time on explaining on the next slides is a publication in Drug Discovery Today. That is the result from last year's fall Allotrope Connect, where we said, hey, it would be really good to put a proceedings report out and kind of put like a first authoritative historical review of the Allotrope Foundation in place. And I'm going to outline that a little bit more on the next slides. And then something else we're currently, well, we kind of finished working on, we submitted it a few weeks ago. It's currently also in review of Drug Discovery Today. It's a paper that I'm going to spend also explaining probably for like 5 minutes today, talking about self-reporting data assets, which I think is a really cool concept that I hope you get excited about too, as well. Okay, so let's have a look here. What did we do after the last, or during the last Allotrope conference? What we did, and you might recall, is we proposed to put like this first Allotrope and BYU collaboration paper out, in which we would go through all of the published literature, starting with the Roberts reports that initiated the ideas that led to the Allotrope Foundation, and then going through all of the publications that you guys have, which might be in small trade journal articles, or it might be posters that have been presented at Allotrope Connect conferences, on a website, or everything that is theoretically in the public domain, we kind of went through and tried to concisely summarize so that we have a holistic overview of what has happened that led to the current state of the Allotrope Foundation. And so we went through that historical part, then we also went through the product development of your three main core products, and we kind of summarized that into three different sections, one like a historical section, one section that talks about the formats and the products, and then one that talked concretely about the presentations that were given at the last Allotrope Connect, for which we used the YouTube videos that were there, and we had three undergrads that learned a lot more about this format than they were expected to when they signed up for the project, but they really enjoyed it. They understood something or learned something that they would have not learned in a normal classroom setting. So for them, it was a great experience. The result of this was that we finished a manuscript a few months after the Allotrope Connect, and we submitted it right before Christmas. Then, of course, peer review always takes a while. So by March, we had it once through the review process and were able to revise and resubmit it. And then end of March, it was accepted. And beginning of April, the first preprint was published by Drug Discovery Today. And then last week, they updated it with the open access proofed version where Allotrope is now capitalized and nice things like that. So just to give you an idea, when we say we want to write a paper with someone, timeline-wise, it typically would take us about 3 to 4 months to write the paper and then another 3 to 4 months to go through the peer review process. So saying something like, hey, let's write a paper within 6 months and having it published is a very aggressive timeline. But we're glad that we were able to deliver at least this first report as promised. So this is currently available. You can download it, you can share it. And that is actually what I would like to point out to you, that these type of reports are not there to boost people's age scores or something like that. They're there to help the Allotrope Foundation. And to me, as a former employee of a member company, I kind of understand that it is important to keep stakeholders excited about Allotrope and where it goes. And so I think a publication like in Drug Discovery Today, that is something that's worthwhile to share. And be it in your social networks, on LinkedIn, or be it in some internal communications, if you have newsletters that update, for example, on what's new in the Allotrope Foundation, it's kind of nice to put like a link to this paper in and just say, hey, here's something that came out from the Altrove Foundation, Dana Vandervalls is on the paper as a co-author. A few of you are mentioned as the in the acknowledgements as contributing, especially Vinny, for example, from Merck, did a lot of editing on the paper and helped us with it. So I think there's quite some content in there that is not academic alone, but really had big impacts from representatives of the Allotrope Foundation. So going ahead and sharing this is not just to boost, like, for some example, the BYU's reputation, but I think it can really help you to put out the message that Allotrope reached a level of maturity where it can withstand critical peer review. And, you know, some of you saw the peer review comments that we got. That was a critical peer review, and we had to adjust and change things. And I think it actually led to the improvement of some of the open source documentation on Allotrope, because some of the reviewers were really not happy with what was currently publicly accessible. But some things have changed and were adjusted and adopted. And so I think it was a really good process that has led now to more open access to what Allotrope really is and gives a broader audience a quick read of what happened to the point where we are right now, but then also gives them access to the next steps to take. And so sharing that with your networks within your companies is hopefully something that will help you establish more credibility for the activities for which you have spent so much time and energy to push them forward, and hopefully also increases the number of adopters going forward. So that's this report. Then let's talk about the other one, the self-reporting data assets. It's an idea I pitched also 6 months ago and said, hey, this is something we want to work on, but we're kind of like scoping it out right now. The basic premise was that everyone wants to do fair. Yeah, everyone wants to have findable, accessible, and proper reusable. We heard it so often, it starts to be, tongue gets lame when we try to say it. The problem is, though, why we say it over and over, do we really know what it means? What is a really fair data set? And how can we ensure that something that from in the lab produces is really fair? It's, you know, there is a discrepancy between the fair data principles and the publications you can read about that and what happens in the daily life of the use case, the people that support the use cases and workflows that we encounter within this foundation. And so based on some of the consulting projects we had done together with Osthus, then projects that happened with Enzontal, and then also different presentations that you guys gave at the Allotrope Connect, it became pretty clear that there is some type of disjunct between what FAIR covers and what you guys really understand under what FAIR needs to deliver. And so our idea was, hey, let's do an investigation. Let's look at some of the workflows and projects that are currently ongoing within the Allotrope Foundation, and let's try to understand what needs to happen for these to be addressed. And do we have to talk about FAIR, or can we talk about a subset of FAIR principles, so to say, that can deliver what is really needed? And so I think that what we ended up with is a pretty powerful concept, this concept of self-reporting data assets, because I think it really specifies what the I and the R mean within the context of FAIR. So what is interoperability and reuse, and how can it be made tangible? Here, a somewhat crude example, but I think it still highlights the point quite well. Imagine there is a shipwreck or airplane wreck or whatever, or maybe you get a data bomb from someone and you have this huge attachment in your email and you have to somehow make sense of what that thing is. With the shipwreck, oftentimes you can find a flight recorder, right? There's something in there that's supposed to contain the last minutes of that wrecked airplane so that you are able to query it and try to find out what's going on in there. But according to current technology, that's always a bit limited, and it's not a perfect representation. What would be really cool, though, is if we would live in a world where you can get this data dump, you extract this thing that you're interested in by maybe the file name only, and then instead of having to call someone up and ask, hey, what is this that you sent me, there is somehow a button you can press, and then you can start to interrogate the data directly. Kind of like as shown with this dude here interrogating Princess Leia. You know, you have the self-reporting in a sense of it's a data asset that you can query, and it tells you by itself what it's all about. And having this active dialogue to understand what it means, that's what I think is the essence of a self-reporting data asset. It completely makes it obsolete to have the additional person to tap into to explain you the context where the data was created. It's all encapsulated in that single file, in one way or another. And so the question that we had was, what are really the requirements that someone would put to one of these self-reporting data assets? Does it have to be a hologram that talks to you, or can it be something else? And so in order to understand that, we had a variety of interviews like Novartis, BMS, GSK, Merck, Agilent, SciX, Ostu, Zontel, and others. They all contributed to us understanding better what these SRDAs mean. And so we derived a set of use cases, and from those, or we collected a set of use cases, and from those we derived user requirements. And then we asked the question, if these are the user requirements, which current technologies or standards are out there that can solve these user requirements? And we identified four representative examples. We have JCamp DX as a standard based on the ASCII technology. We have JSON as a example proxy for all types of text-based formats that are out there. Then NEML as a standard based on the XML technology, and then Allotrope as the standard based on HDF5 and the ontologies. So having those in place and the user requirements allowed us to run a fit gap analysis. And that is really the main result of this SRDA report that we put together. And just to give you a highlight of it, here is the results of this fit gap analysis. So this is a pretty full slide. I'm not going to go through all of the rows here, but just letting you know that from the different use cases, we derived specific requirements with a title here. They're in the paper, they're a little bit better explained of what they actually stand for. And then we do kind of a category-based comparison of the four different standards and technologies against those requirements. And what might be visually quite clear, but important to mention again on the verbal for those who have a red-green weakness, there's a lot of green on the right side for the ADF column. So initially, we didn't quite know what would come out of this. We tried to have it as a scientific exercise to go through the analysis. But once we had it all put together, it was pretty clear that from a very objective view, the Allotrope data format checks most of the boxes. And we actually only found three of the boxes that had a partial fill. One of them was the ease of generation, and many of you are aware of it. Now, that's probably the reason for the new strategic shift towards more of a Allotrope simple model. Generation of Allotrope files is not easy. If you tell a guy in the lab, hey, don't send me this report as a PDF, please send it to me as an ADF, he will have some trouble of creating that. And so I think that's sort of the cost that comes with standardization. If you bring to plate a lot of rules and governance of how to annotate and structure data, it's going to be more complicated than just opening up a text editor and writing a few lines of JSON text. While that is really fast and effective, and for certain purposes it's great, for example, ease of generation, for things like long-term stability, it might not be the best choice. And so there's always a trade-off, right? And the reason why we make this, for example, orange here for Allotrope is that while it is not easy for an individual person to write from scratch an Allotrope file, I would say writing from scratch an MP3 file is also not easy for someone that produces music. What you want to have is something in place that helps you to write these files. And we see now with in the Allotrope Foundation and the partner network, there's an increasing number of solutions that becomes available that can actually make it more feasible for people to create Allotrope files. We had a great presentation last conference, and I think it was Pfizer who presented on how they Boehringer and Pfizer maybe together, they presented on how they can rapidly generate Allotrope files. We have the Zontel pipeline in place that makes you Allotrope files out of anything, really high quality ones as well. And then we have a lot of other tools that are being built. Agilent has some solutions now available that can produce Allotrope files. So it becomes more accessible more likely accessible to a researcher in the lab to have a tool that can spit out an Allotrope file. But until that is really broadly available, or maybe through the Allotrope simple model will be broadly available, we would give this a partial fit only. However, then other things like the data models that are currently being needed for the use cases, the LCUV is pretty much there. The NMR and the mass spec, those are things we're working on. And so I think it's nice in this objective overview to also show that there are current things that are not perfectly in place, but the trajectory looks like Allotrope is going to deliver or has delivered and will keep to deliver. So overall, I think that was a very positive assessment of the Allotrope format, very favorable. And I'm excited about it because after having spent a few years with this format, I like it to not be all red and orange. So seems you guys have done a great job of engineering it and putting the right user requirements in place. That being said, short review of this here. So this article corresponding to it was submitted to Drug Discovery Today. It has a few of you guys as co-authors on it, like Heiko from Agilent is on it, and Dana, and a lot of you, like John from GSK and Vinny from Merck, have contributed substantially to the writing of that manuscript. So those guys are all mentioned within the context of the acknowledgements. And so overall, I think this will be a really good second publication to show the collaboration between BYU and the Allotrope Foundation. Overall, I can say that this SRDA concept is promising. I think it's a very powerful concept, and it would be really interesting to see if we consider SRDAs to be a subset of the FAIR data principles. How does Allotrope, after solving SRDAs, now solve the overarching problem of FAIR data? And so we are excited right now to explore that as well. However, with the new strategic shift of the Allotrope Foundation, we have to see how much sense it makes to really compare just the Allotrope data format, or if we should maybe wait until the end of this year and understand what the Allotrope simple model will look like and how the interplay between both might be a better solution to that problem. So in conclusion, I'd just like to thank everyone that helped out. The Allotrope Foundation was really open and nice. They embraced us as an academic partner and had lots of open discussions with us. I know you guys are all super busy, so really grateful that you took the time to talk to me and my students. But I also know that some of you have worked really, really hard on solving some problems that were really, really big, but maybe not everyone within the enterprise has fully appreciated that. And so while maybe management does not really care about things that advance science overall, I think if we combine our different strengths and use, for example, BYU as an academic partner to push some of your insights about data standardization and the benefits of it to the broader community, that we can really help you get your valuable insights accessible to a large audience and overall lead to a, you know, more satisfying result at the end of the day. So with this, I'm open to any questions or remarks, and please feel free to reach out to me after this conference to discuss any other topics you might be interested in exploring for their scientific publication viability. With this, thank you very much.
Great, thanks, Dennis. Jamie, do you have any questions that have come in?
Yeah, there's two questions. I'll just forward them over to Dennis so we can see them.
Great, thanks.
All right, Dennis, you should see them in your panel.
Okay, so by what criteria is long-term stable defined in the comparison analysis? So a long-term stable means to us that if you would save the file right now, what is the likelihood that someone in 20 years can open that file again and still understand it? So a long-term stable format is, if you think about Microsoft, they had some version changes. So opening any original Word document from 1998 or so, that's not going to be very feasible today anymore. The HDF5 format, however, is effectively a data format that's been around for 20 to 30 years for satellite communication. Opening and interpreting those is more likely to be able to work. A PDF would be also an example of a long-term stable data format because there are just really strong standards around it that govern how to read it. And even if for some reason you would not be able to read that file anymore because the Allotrope, the Acrobat Reader in 20 years can't do it anymore, the specifications are still around, so you could recreate it if necessary. If you think about AnyML, for example, that doesn't really have an official specification set yet, that would not really be a fully long-term stable format because it was never quite agreed on what the status or the standard was at the time when the file was being created. JCampDX doesn't work. Bruker might have the full specifications, but it's not completely in a public domain. And JSON is not really a standard anyway yet. So just as a language or technology at this point, there is not really anything that can say that we can say, okay, a JSON file has to uphold to A, B, and C in order to be considered a data format. And so in the future, it might be readable, but if we encode anything more than just plain text description in it, it would be probably very hard to reference and open up again and understand fully. I'm a bit over time. Do you want me to respond to the other ones via chat, or should I answer them now?
Let's do it via chat. And if we have time at the end, we can swing back. But if you could just type it in, that'd be great. And then if anyone with their hand raised wants to put their questions into the chat box, into the question window, that'd be great too. But I think we should move to the next one.
Okay, then thank you again.
Thanks so. Yeah, thank you very much, Dennis.